Today we will discuss lock-in amplifiers and we will see how we can use this device in scanning tunneling spectroscopy. So let's start with the purpose and the application of lock-in amplifier. Why we need this thing? And to understand this thing, we need to understand what scanning tunneling spectroscopy is. Let me make a simple diagram of an STM. This is my tip. This is the substrate. And the tip is connected with a biasing voltage power supply, which is also connected to an ampere meter, where we will calculate the current passing from the tip to the substrate. So what we basically want to do is we want to change the voltage from here and then see how much current is tunneling through. Let's call it I tunneling. So I tunneling, and we'll be having current here, and let's say it has some behavior like this. And from this IV response, we can basically measure the slope at any given point of this graph. So at any given energy, which will be basically equal to E into V for given voltage, the slope can be defined as DI over DV. So that will be the amount of current passing through, which is tunneling through this gap at this voltage. And at that particular voltage, we will be having this slope DI over DV, which will be basically tunneling resistance, or tunneling, there will be tunneling conductance basically. So how much current is tunneling. And this is important, DI over DV is important in studies of scanning tunneling spectroscopy because they are directly proportional to the density of the states in the substrate or and the tip. So more density of states available, we'll be having higher DI over DV. So we can basically estimate density of states using this simple setup. But there's a problem measuring this DI over DV. And what that is, let's see. The problem is that current we measure is, this is an ideal situation. In reality, there will be a lot of noise coming in. So what we'll be measuring here will be a current which will contain tunneling current plus a lot of noise. And a lot of time the noise is so big that plot you will see will be totally noisy. And the real tunneling current is hidden inside this noise. It's buried so deep in, we cannot draw any conclusive results or anything in useful. So what's the way forward? How we can get rid of this noise and extract the tunneling current from it? So here's a clever thing which scientists do in their experiments. What they do is, for example, this is our, so what they do is basically they add up a signal here in this bias voltage. So this is V biased. So they add another non-signal in this bias voltage, ideally a sinusoidal function. So what is it? So let me remove this. Let's write a T. So it's a time-dependent function. So what will be happening? So for example, in our experiment, we were increasing the voltage, the bias voltage, in a linear form. So V biased was increasing linearly over time. So what we do is we add up in our V biased a sinusoidal function. So this is just a general way to write a sinusoidal function where we have frequency of the sinusoidal function is f, and this is some offset which we are showing here. Now what this will do is basically is now your biasing voltage, your input signal, let's call it V input. So V input is a sinusoidal function. It also contains your bias voltage. If your voltage here is changing sinusoidally, what will happen? Your tunneling current that is being produced due to this biasing will also be in the same form. It will also be sinusoidal with exact same frequency, or maybe some of its harmonic. It could be of the same frequency, maybe it has, due to some internal circuitry issues, it can be twice the frequency, but it will be always an integer multiple of the original frequency. It could be 1f, 2f, 3f, whatever. So now basically what we have done is we know that our signal, our real tunneling current, which is our signal, is sinusoidal, plus we know its frequency. Of course, the noise will still be random. It will be coming from some other sources other than our bias voltage. So noise will still be random. But now we know that in this random noisy signal, there is a hidden frequency, and that frequency will be exactly equal to f. If we can amplify that frequency out of this signal so large that our original signal, the signal to noise ratio is now good, and we can detect our tunneling current. So we need to lock into that certain frequency at which the signal is coming, and to do that we use lock-in amplifiers. So what's going on here is basically so I'm gonna draw a block diagram of this whole setup. So we have our STM, which takes a biasing voltage as input, and it gives out a tunneling current as output. But because tunneling current was having a lot of noise, to correctly detect I tunneling, what we will do is we will give this tunneling current input to our lock-in amplifier. Of course, we will not give this directly into lock-in amplifier. We will convert first into voltage form. So current to voltage conversion, and then we will give it as input to login amplifier. The thing is, we were giving this bias voltage, V biased, which we were supposed to apply to STM. What we're doing is we add up our function here of certain frequency into V bias, and then that biasing voltage become V input to STM. And the same function, or maybe some of its integral multiple to detect the higher harmonics, we give it to the login amplifier. So what login amplifier will do, it will subtract, it will lock into this frequency and give you the I tunneling. How does login amplifier do that? We will learn in the next section.